What's going on, guys? My name is Embrace the Pace, and with the NBA draft happening tomorrow night, I thought this would be a perfect time to go ahead and put out a mock draft video. So that's what we're going to be doing today. I'm going to be going through the first 10 picks of the draft and telling you guys what I would do if I were those teams with their pick in the top 10. Now, I'm only going to go through the top 10 because after that, you know, obviously you could go on for hours about where you think guys are going to get picked outside of the top 10. But I am going to make another video where I just talk about probably five prospects that will most likely be available outside of the top 10 that I really like a lot and I think you guys should keep your eyes on. So look out for that video as well. But with that being said, let's go ahead and jump into this. Now, before I jump into my picks, I do want to preface this video by saying all of the selections I'm going to be talking about here are specifically what I would do if I were that NBA team. These are not projections. These are not what I think is going to happen, even though we will get into that a little bit. But this is what I would do if I were the NBA team. I just want to explain that to you guys because projections and personal preference are definitely different at times. So I just want to let you guys know, this is what I would do if I had the pick, not necessarily what I think is actually going to happen. So with the number one pick, I think it's very, very clear that the 76ers are going to be selecting Markelle Fultz. They made that huge trade with the Celtics, and ever since then, it's been the worst kept secret in the NBA. Everyone knows the Sixers are going to be picking Markelle Fultz, and I completely agree with that pick. That's what I would do as well. Really, the only knock I see on Fultz is that he didn't win at the college level, and he does deserve a little bit of the blame for that. But on the whole, Washington's team was very, very bad last year. Their coaching staff was bad, so you can't put all the blame on Fultz. Fultz was also injured for part of the year as well, but overall, I don't see that as very much of a concern because other than that, he's pretty much a dream point guard prospect. He checks every single box from a skill standpoint. He can attack the basket, he can shoot mid-range shots, he can shoot the three, he has the physical tools to play defense. He's not a great defender right now, but again, he has the physical tools. He's got the NBA ready body to where he could come in and guard guys. He's got the size. He's 6'4, close to 200 pounds, got a 6'10 wingspan. He's a relatively good athlete, not an elite athlete, but definitely, you know, average to above average. He can pass the ball. He's a good rebounder for a point guard. He really checks every single box, and he also fits that mold of a prototypical NBA point guard with the size and the skill set to play pick and roll and everything like that. I think he's pretty much a dream point guard prospect, and I don't see the Sixers making any mistake at all in picking Markelle Fultz. He's pretty much the no-brainer number one pick to me. There isn't a lot of mystery around the number two pick as well. Pretty much since the draft lottery, we've known that the Lakers were probably going to pick Lonzo Ball. And after trading D'Angelo Russell to Brooklyn the other day, it's pretty much a guarantee that they will be taking Lonzo Ball. And I agree with that pick. That's the pick that I would make if I were the Lakers. Now, Lonzo Ball isn't as complete of a prospect as Markelle Fultz is. He doesn't check every single box. He's not a good defender. His frame isn't that great, and he doesn't have much of a mid-range game at all, but he does have some skills that are elite by NBA standards that you can pretty much bank on them translating to the next level, and those skills are about as elite as you can get in a prospect, especially a prospect that's only 19, 20 years old coming to the NBA as a one and done. And those skills for him are his passing ability and his court vision. Now, you don't really see too many guys his age coming into the NBA that have that type of court vision. It's 100% elite. He's going to make his teammates better, and that's a huge key, especially for the Lakers who have some young guys. Brandon Ingram has really a lot of potential, but he's not there yet. Julius Randle, who knows if they'll trade him or Jordan Clarkson to try to get Paul George. That's a topic for another video. But he'll be able to make these young players better with his passing skill. Also, it's really nice when you're thinking about getting superstars into LA like Paul George, or even some people think that LeBron's in play for 2018. I really don't know about that. But bottom line, the Lakers want to try to bring in superstars. And when your point guard is a pass-first point guard that doesn't need to have the ball in his hand, that's a huge, huge luxury because he can basically defer to those superstars and he can get them open shots because he's got, like I said, elite passing, elite court vision. That's something that's great. His other skills, he is an excellent shooter, and he's shown that his entire career. Personally, I'm still a little bit concerned about the jump shot. I know it goes in. I know it's been going in his whole career, but there just haven't been very many great shooters in NBA history that have a release that looks like that. I would personally want him to clean that up. I could be completely wrong. Again, it's not a huge concern, but that's something that I would definitely look at. But overall, I think Lonzo Ball is the best pick at number two for the Lakers. Number three to Boston gets a little bit interesting. I think they could definitely try to trade that and maybe get Jimmy Butler. I don't know. We haven't really heard too much about that over the last couple days, and the draft is getting closer, so I don't know if that will happen. I feel like they'll end up picking with it. And if I had their pick, it would definitely be between Josh Jackson and Jason Tatum. That's pretty much a given. I think I would honestly lean more towards Jason Tatum right now than Josh Jackson, and let me explain why. So Jason Tatum, I've been high on Jason Tatum for a while. Just watching him in college, he is an unbelievable scorer, and he's an NBA ready scorer right now. His frame isn't incredible, but it's not bad. But his offensive game is so advanced. You don't see guys like that that are one and done players at, again, 19, 20 years old that have that type of offensive game. He can score inside, he can score outside, he can score in the mid-range. He's got an incredibly good mid-range game. He's a good ball handler, he has great size, he's got the tools to be a good defender. Overall, I think he would fit the Celtics a little bit better, and the only reason I say that is because the Celtics just picked up Jaylen Brown last year, and Jaylen Brown is at the same position as Jason Tatum and Josh Jackson. He's a wing player, and Jaylen Brown is more of a defensive specialist. So if you bring in Josh Jackson, who's also a defensive specialist, even though I think Josh Jackson's a higher level, you know, prospect than Jaylen Brown, it's kind of a little bit of an overlap. So I think you kind of get the best of both worlds. You get that defensive specialist in Jaylen Brown, and you get that offensive specialist in Jason Tatum, and I think that would work well. And then even if you want to get rid of one of those guys, you can, you know, try to trade them away for a superstar. The Celtics are in a really interesting spot because they're right on the brink of being able to really contend. They're like one massive piece away to be able to possibly challenge the Cavs and win the Eastern Conference. Will they be able to challenge the Warriors? Obviously, we don't know that. The chances are they won't, unless they really go all out and they're able to get someone like Jimmy Butler, and then in free agency pick up Gordon Hayward or Blake Griffin. But again, who knows about that? That's a topic for another video. But at number three, I think the better pick would be Jason Tatum. That's where I would lean right now. And I think that's probably what they'll do, because Josh Jackson didn't actually work out for the Celtics. There were a lot of reports that the Celtics love Josh Jackson, but him not working out for them at all is a little bit surprising. I don't know what that necessarily means. You can take that for whatever you think it means, but I would lean more towards Jason Tatum right now if I had to pick. At number four to Phoenix, I think the pick has to be Josh Jackson. He fits well there. That would give them a high energy wing defender. I think he could flourish. Josh Jackson is an elite defender with a high motor and a lot of athleticism. On the offensive end, he's a little raw. He showed towards the end of the year that he shot the three really well. Like the last half of the season, I think he shot over 50% from three, but his release isn't that consistent. It's a little bit low. You don't know how quickly that'll translate, but overall, I look at Josh Jackson as a very, very elite prospect, and I think the Suns should definitely go that direction with their pick at number four. At number five, I think the Kings are going to end up going with De'Aaron Fox, and I agree with that pick as well. That's what I would do. They're in a 100% total rebuild at this point after trading DeMarcus Cousins last season, and one of the most important pieces, if not the most important piece you can have, is a lead point guard, and De'Aaron Fox fits that bill. He's one of my favorite prospects in the draft. He shot really poorly at Kentucky this year, literally like close to 20%, I think. So he'll need to develop that part of his game. Maybe that season was just a little bit of an anomaly and he might, you know, end up shooting the ball better in the NBA. We'll have to see. He'll definitely need to work on that. He is a little bit skinny right now. I think he's only at about 170 pounds or so. So he'll need to develop that a little bit as well. But overall, overall, just super, super athletic, extremely fast. He can distribute the ball. He can get to the rim. He's an elite defender, very, very elite defender, and I love two-way players. So I think De'Aaron Fox is a great fit for the Kings, and I think they'll end up picking him at number 5. After the top 5, things start getting a little bit more hazy. We don't really know. There could be a lot of fluctuation going on. But at number 6 for the Magic, I would personally take Jonathan Isaac, just because Jonathan Isaac kind of fits a need for that team, and he's got an extremely high ceiling. Now, right now, I don't think Jonathan Isaac is going to come into the NBA and immediately be able to produce at a super high level like I think Markelle Fultz or Lonzo Ball or Josh Jackson or Jason Tatum will be able to do. But I think he's a long-term prospect that probably won't take an incredibly long time. His body and everything is better than Brandon Ingram right now. He's further along from a physical standpoint, and he's got some skills as well. Long arms. He's like 6'9", 6'10", I believe. And he can shoot the three a little bit. He's athletic. He can defend really well. Overall, I think he is a safe pick. I could also see them taking hard looks at Malik Monk at 6. And they could even look at Dennis Smith Jr. or Frank Ntilikina at number 6 as well, depending on how confident they are with Elfrid Payton. But Malik Monk is the only one that I think could possibly stop them from taking Isaac at 6. So if I were them, I'd probably take Isaac, but Monk would be very tempting as well. Now, there's been a little bit of chatter about the Mavericks and the Timberwolves trading their picks, but in this scenario, the Wolves still have the pick, and if they do and Jonathan Isaac is off the board, I think they should take Lauri Markkanen out of Arizona. He would fit into their system perfectly. They need a power forward. He's a lethal offensive player, a 7-footer that can shoot threes extremely well. He's not a great rebounder. He's not a great defender. But once again, you don't see too many 7-footers that can score the ball as well as he can, and I think he would be a great fit in Minnesota. So like I said, if Isaac is off the board, if Isaac is on the board, I probably go with Isaac. But otherwise, Lauri Markkanen is the guy for the Timberwolves. The Knicks are in an interesting situation at number 8 because they definitely need to draft a point guard, but in this scenario, Malik Monk is still on the board, and personally, I think if the Knicks can pick up Malik Monk at 8, they should probably do it. That's what I would do. Do I think they'll do that? I don't know. I think Malik Monk could possibly go number 6 to the Magic. If Malik Monk is available at 8, I would not be surprised at all if they go with them, or if they go with him. But I also wouldn't be surprised if they go with Dennis Smith or Frank Ntilikina. So personally, I would take Malik Monk at 8 if he is available. And at number 9 to the Mavericks, it's basically a toss-up between Frank Ntilikina and Dennis Smith Jr. I lean a little bit more towards Dennis Smith just because he's more of a known quantity and he's a complete freak athlete and he can get to the rim extremely well. But Frank Ntilikina has better NBA size, but he's not as good of an athlete. He's probably a little bit better of a distributor. So it's really a toss-up there. I think the Mavericks would lean more towards Ntilikina because they've been on him for a while. But personally, I would lean more towards Dennis Smith at number 9 to the Mavericks. And at number 10 to the Kings, their second pick in the top 10, I have something that probably a lot of people don't. If I were the Kings at number 10 and the first 9 picks go how I just explained, I think I go with OG Anunoby out of Indiana. And let me explain that to you. So even though a lot of people don't have him all the way as high as number 10, a lot of people think Zach Collins is going to be the pick. There are even a couple other guys that could possibly be picked there. The reason why I lean towards Anunoby is because after the first 9 picks or so, I think there's a significant drop-off in this draft. I think there are some elite-type players in the top 10, but once you pass those guys, I don't think there's too much depth, and I don't think there's too much separation between these guys. So what I would do if I were the team is I would look for translatable NBA skills that you know you can get. And OG Anunoby is an elite level NBA defender. His physical tools are off the charts. He's about 6'8 with a 7'3 wingspan, a chiseled frame. He's a very, very, very good defender. He doesn't just have the tools, he's a great defender as well. He did tear his ACL, but according to reports and stuff, it seems like he's going to be good with that. On the offensive end of the floor, he's not really that good. He can shoot spot up threes a little bit. Other than that, he showed some flashes of being able to drive to the basket and finish at the rim. But really, he doesn't give you too much on the offensive end of the floor right now. Hopefully, he could develop that three-point shot into something very consistent. But once again, I feel like he's somebody that's going to be able to lock down superstars from day one in the NBA, especially years down the line. And the way I look at it is the Kings are a little bit further away from being relevant. You know, they might be a long way away from being relevant. But if they eventually want to get to the point where they're competing for championships, they're going to end up running into superstar players. They're going to end up running into guys, you know, that are pretty much unstoppable. You look, if they're in the Western Conference, you know, you look, you're going to have to go up against Kawhi Leonard. You might have to go up against LeBron James. You're going to end up going against guys that are physical specimens that can score the ball. And if you don't have somebody that can defend them, you're going to be at a massive disadvantage. And I look at OG Anunoby as somebody who can step in and he can defend extremely good players from day one. And like I said, there's not a ton of separation between a lot of these guys. I'm not as high on guys like Zach Collins as a lot of other people are. So at number 10, if I'm the Kings, I'm taking a little bit of a stretch and I'm taking OG Anunoby. So that is my top 10 for the 2017 NBA draft, if I had those picks. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Make sure to let me know in the comment section below what you think about my top 10. Also, let me know what you guys would do if you had the first 10 picks, and also what you think might happen. Just let me know down in the comment section below. I'm super excited for the draft. NBA draft season is one of the best times of year. The NBA offseason in general is always extremely fun, and we've definitely had a lot of excitement so far. And there's much more to come. So I only covered the top 10 in this video, but I am going to post another video where I talk about some guys that will most likely be available outside of the top 10. And I'm going to let you guys know who I really like and who I think you guys should be looking out for. So look forward to that video. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll talk to you guys later.